This is a Bibliomotion audiobook, produced and distributed by Gildan Media in partnership with Bibliomotion. Conversational Intelligence: How Great Leaders Build Trust and Get Extraordinary Results, by Judith E. Glaser. Read by Karen Saltus. We hope you enjoy this program. Introduction: Discovering a New Intelligence. You never change things by fighting the existing reality. To change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete. Buckminster Fuller. Conversations are not what we think they are. We've grown up with a narrow view of conversations, thinking they are about talking, sharing information, telling people what to do, or telling others what's on our minds. We are now learning through neurological and cognitive research that a conversation goes deeper and is more robust than simple information sharing. Conversations are dynamic, interactive, and inclusive. They evolve and impact the way we connect, engage, interact, and influence others, enabling us to shape reality, mindsets, events, and outcomes in a collaborative way. Conversations have the power to move us from power over others to power with others, giving us the exquisite ability to get on the same page with our fellow humans and experience the same reality by bridging the reality gaps between how you see things and how I see things. Conversational intelligence is what separates those who are successful from those who are not, in business, in relationships, and even in marriages. For more than half a century, I've studied this phenomenon. My passion to make sense of conversations was launched at a young age and has propelled me forward into research, writing, and consulting that drives my waking and sleeping moments. Without healthy conversations, we shrivel up and die. That is what we are now learning from the world of neuroscience. It is through conversations that we connect and communicate. They are the source of energy that moves us out of our doldrums when we are sad, and they are the power that launches transformational products into the world. Conversations are the golden threads that enable us to move forward and trust others. But these threads can also unravel, causing us to run from others in fear of loss and pain. Words are not things. They are the representations and symbols we use to view, think about, and process our perceptions of reality. And they are the means of sharing these perceptions with others. Yet few leaders understand how vital conversation is to the health and productivity of their company culture. Unhealthy conversations are at the root of distrust, deceit, betrayal, and avoidance, which leads to lower productivity and innovation, and ultimately, lower success. By understanding how conversations trigger different parts of our brain and how they either catalyze or freeze our brains in protective patterns, you can develop the conversational skills that propel individuals, teams, and organizations towards success. Conversational intelligence is learnable, and it is necessary to build healthier, more resilient organizations in the face of change. A seemingly simple act, such as talking with a colleague, a short exchange of words in a hallway, has the ability to alter someone's life permanently. Phrases like, "You can't do that," and "If you only knew how," may take only seconds to utter, but they can be life-changing. There is little connection between the time it takes to say the words and the lasting impact they may have on a person, a relationship, or an organization. Because our words are so powerful, we must understand and develop conversational intelligence, a framework and perspective that lets us see how conversations create powerful links between relationships and culture. Conversations are the way we connect, engage, navigate, and transform the world with others. The premise of conversational intelligence is, to get to the next level of greatness depends on the quality of our culture, which depends on the quality of our relationships, which depends on the quality of our conversations. Everything happens through conversations. 1. Conversational intelligence gives us the power to influence our neurochemistry, even in the moment. Every conversation we have with another person has a chemical component. Conversations have the power to change the brain. They stimulate the production of hormones and neurotransmitters, stimulate body systems and nerve pathways, and change our body's chemistry, not just for a moment, but perhaps for a lifetime. At the simplest level, we say something and we get a response. I ask you a question and you tell me the answer. However, conversations can quickly become more complex as questions provoke thoughts and feelings about what you mean or your intentions. And this stirs our chemical networks into action. If questions feel threatening, we do more than answer. We activate networks inside the brain to handle the threat. 2. Conversational intelligence gives us the power to express our inner thoughts and feelings to one another in ways that can strengthen relationships and success. As we communicate, we read the content and emotions being sent our way, and we likewise send content and emotions to others. Conversations are more than the information we share and the words we speak. They offer a way to package our feelings about our world, others, and ourselves. As leaders, we communicate that we are sad or happy with almost every conversation. As we come to understand the power of language in regulating how people feel every day, and the role language plays in the brain's capacity to expand perspectives and create a feel-good experience, we can learn to shape our workplace in profound ways. 3. Conversational intelligence gives us the power to influence the way we interpret reality. Conversations impact different parts of the brain in different ways, because different parts of the brain are listening for different things. By understanding the way conversations impact our listening, we can determine how we listen, and how we listen determines how we interpret and make sense of our world. What is conversational intelligence? In working with hundreds of companies and tens of thousands of employees in many of the nation's largest organizations over the last 30 years, I've discovered that a lack of conversational intelligence, CIQ, is at the root of breakdowns in many relationships. Simply put, conversational intelligence is essential to an organization's ability to create shared meaning about what needs to be accomplished and why, so that employees get excited and are clear about the future they are helping to create together. Conversational intelligence will enable you to discern the types of conversations that are suited for different situations. At one end of the conversational continuum are conversations that allow us to transact business and share information with one another, which I call level one. As we move across the continuum, we engage in positional conversations, those in which we have a strong voice and point of view, and work to influence others to understand or accept our view of the world. These are level two conversations. And as we reach the highest level, which I call level three, we are communicating with others to transform and shape reality together, a powerful type I refer to as co-creating conversations. Co-creating conversations are the highest form of conversation. They led us to not only advance our conversations with others, I believe they're actually writing new DNA that can be passed along to the next generation. Co-creation is a set of skills and a complementary mindset that enable you to have extraordinary, transformational conversations with others. Do we all have the ability to reach level three? Researchers in neuroscience are demonstrating that the capacity to operate at level three is hardwired into all human beings, present in our more recently developed brain, the prefrontal cortex, or executive brain. Our prefrontal cortex is activated when we feel we can trust others, and is deactivated when we feel high levels of fear and distrust. All human beings are built for level three. Yet most environments do not encourage this capacity in us, and many, in fact, discourage it. Understanding all three levels of conversational intelligence and how to activate them is vital to success. As a starting place, it's important to know that conversational intelligence is a competence that can be cultivated. It allows us to connect, engage, and navigate with others, and it is the single most important intelligence that gets better when we do it, meaning that our individual capacity for conversational intelligence expands when we practice it with others and when we all focus on it together. While the other intelligences are more I-centric in nature, they are intelligences we develop individually, such as mathematical intelligence or linguistic intelligence. Conversational intelligence exists as a collaborative effort, and when we practice it together, we raise the CIQ of relationships, and we can also raise the CIQ of teams and organizations. And because CIQ leverages all other kinds of individual intelligences, there is neither a more powerful skill nor a more necessary one to master. Conversational intelligence provides a framework and practices for the way individuals, teams, and organizations listen, engage, architect, and influence the moment and shape the future in all situations. When we use our CIQ in business, we strengthen the organization's culture in order to achieve greater business results. Understanding how to level set our conversations gives us the power to transform reality. The map is not the territory. In 1931, Alfred Korzybski, a Polish-American scientist and philosopher, coined the phrase, "The map is not the territory," to distinguish the words we use to describe reality from reality itself. Korzybski said that we often confuse the map, the way our minds represent reality, with the territory, our physical reality, and don't realize we are confusing the two. We communicate with others as though we all share the same map and the same world, which causes conflict and collisions. To become good at CIQ, we need to recognize that the map is not the territory and spend more time joining the two through conversations. What makes CIQ so exciting as a discipline is that, through the incredible amount of neuroscience research taking place around the world right now, we are able to understand more about the way our minds create biases, blind spots, and filters that prevent us from seeing reality as it is. Understanding the science behind conversations will appear throughout the book. As importantly, we are learning from coaches, consultants, and people who are learning to boost their conversational intelligence that this knowledge plus the related skills are not only learnable, they are essential for our success as individuals, teams, and organizations, even as a species. Conversational intelligence is about creating an ongoing dialogue with others, to explore our maps, which I refer to as our movies, and to stay in touch with one another's evolution of thinking as we work together to achieve shared goals. Whether you are working in a small business or a large global company, elevating your CIQ will be a life-changing experience that will not only yield business results, it will create new energy for transformation and growth. Turning adversaries into partners. My earliest official foray into teaching people about conversational intelligence began with one of my first clients, Boehringer Ingelheim, a global pharmaceutical company that hired me to work with its sales training and development group. When we started the project, BI sales representatives were not getting as many appointments with doctors, who make decisions about what drugs to prescribe, as were reps from other pharmaceutical companies, which translated directly into fewer sales and lower profits. In a comparison of the sales forces of 40 pharmaceutical companies, Boehringer was rated 39th, not exactly a great position. My job was to figure out what Boehringer's sales reps were doing to create so much resistance, and then to design a program to help the BI sales development team build rapport with doctors. Over a period of weeks, the BI team and I plunged into our discovery work. We observed dozens of typical sales calls, with new reps as well as seasoned ones, and then we deconstructed the sales encounter, mapping the conversations and their outcomes. We paid special attention to nonverbal cues, including tone of voice and body language, like posture and facial expression. The BI sales reps had been taught to use a traditional features and benefits model of selling. This meant that if the physician raised concerns about the product during a sales call, reps were taught to handle objections by either providing additional facts about the product or by trying to persuade the physician that her issue was not really important. This approach was based on using rational arguments and supporting data to make the objections go away. Even the word objections assumes an adversarial relationship, though the reps didn't realize that. They had been taught to handle them, and handle them they did. Because they saw their success as dependent upon eliminating objections, they became very good at argument and persuasive language. However, the physicians on the other end of the conversations sensed that they were being steamrolled, which led them to stiffen their resistance or try to end the appointment as soon as possible. Rather than connecting with the sales reps, the doctors we observed showed nonverbal signs of pushing them away. Change one thing, change everything. The doctors that Beringer sales reps called on quickly learned to see the reps as adversaries rather than friends. Not only did the moments of contact make no progress toward getting to we, the meetings became power struggles during which the sales reps unintentionally encouraged the doctors to write them off instead of writing their prescriptions. Eureka! Now that we had discovered the problem, we decided that instead of focusing on handling objections, the reps should eliminate that phrase from their vocabulary altogether. We taught them how to reframe the interaction and use a new word to label what was going on. We asked reps to consider their interactions with the physician from a new point of view, to pay close attention to nonverbal cues, and to be more sensitive to the impact they were having. During this process, we helped the reps completely reframe their view of the physician's questions. Where they once saw questions as objections, they now were encouraged to see them as simple requests for additional information. This new way of viewing the sales dynamic had a profound effect on the relationship between sales rep and physician, resulting in a shift away from handling physician objections and toward building a relationship with the physician. What happens at the moment of contact defines the relationship. As the reps learned how to shift from focusing on selling first, and often it was hard selling, to relationship before task, the physicians felt that the reps and BI as a company were partnering with them in helping better serve their patients. At a deeper level, the physicians began to trust their BI reps, and BI's business increased. Within a year, both peers and customers ranked the Beringer Ingelheim sales force as one of the most respected sales organizations in the pharmaceutical business. We gave the program the acronym BEST, which stood for Beringer Ingelheim Effective Sales Training, and it enabled the sales executives to become the best in the industry. The neuroscience of we. What we learned from deconstructing the moment of contact and the sales calls between the physicians and the reps supports what I call the neuroscience of we. During their early interactions, the sales reps were triggering the physician's amygdala, a part of the brain that has long been associated with our mental and emotional fear state. By turning their meetings with doctors into a battle, the sales reps were activating the circuitry of fight and flight, rather than creating in the doctors a desire to prescribe Beringer products. Without realizing it, the physicians were reacting instinctively. They were closing down and protecting themselves from potential harm. Figure 1-1. Please refer to this figure on the accompanying PDF download. Star skills. Star skills. Build rapport. Needs. Listen actively. Ask smart questions. Reinforce success. Dramatize your message. To get to the root of the issue, I developed a program that taught the sales reps star skills. Skills that achieve results. Those skills are 1. Building rapport. 2. Listening without judgment. 3. Asking discovery questions. 4. Reinforcing success. And 5. Dramatizing the message. These skills are simple, powerful, and get at the heart of building trusting relationships. They draw on a part of the brain known as the reticular activating system, RAS, associated with many vitally important functions. The most critical component of selling is conscious and focused attention. Building rapport focuses us on getting on the same wavelength as the person with whom we are talking. Listening without judgment involves paying full attention to the other person as he speaks, while consciously setting aside the tendency to judge the other person. Asking discovery questions opens our minds to the power of curiosity, as well as to the possibility of changing our views as we listen and learn. Reinforcing success and dramatizing the message, the last two skills, also play a role in sustaining a healthy, trusting relationship. Reinforcing success focuses us on seeing and validating what success looks like for both people, which eliminates uncertainty and moves people into action through greater connectivity and coherence. Dramatizing the message is a reminder that we need to be alert to whether our messages are clear and understood by others. When we fail to connect in the way we communicate, we can try saying it another way, telling a story or showing a picture of what we're trying to say. These dramatizations move us toward greater understanding with others, elevating trust and strengthening the relationship. This elevates our awareness to stay in sync until we are certain we are on the same wavelength. When we are, we achieve coherence with others. Star skills serve as guide points for our engagement process, but they are also designed to create a positive shift in brain chemistry. Supportive engagement makes us feel safe, as the oxytocin we release during such conversations enhances our feelings of bonding, and dopamine and serotonin contribute to feelings of well-being. These neurotransmitters tamp down the defensive role of the amygdala, freeing the prefrontal cortex, the more recently evolved part of the human brain, to allow new ideas, insights, and wisdom to emerge. This part of the brain also contains the mirror neurons that allow us to feel empathy for one another. When I was working with Beringer, scientists were not yet using fMRIs, functional magnetic resonance imaging, to look inside our brains at the moment of social contact. No one could actually see inside the minds of the sales reps and doctors to see when they were in sync. Yet we could certainly observe what happened when they did learn to build trust. The sales reps' use of the 5-star skills had an extraordinary impact on the physicians, quelling the doctors' more primal reactions and allowing the reps to engage the more positive impulses that some researchers call the heart brain. Using star skills, the reps were also able to engage the doctor's prefrontal cortex, with its ability for strategy and planning. We know strategies worked because not only did this shift lead to more open communication and higher levels of trust during sales calls, it led to higher levels of commitment to the Beringer brand and its products. Through the star skills program, the reps learned to not only change their language, but to create a totally new relationship with physicians, moving from adversaries to trusted partners. Within 18 months, Beringer Ingelheim had dramatically increased sales and expanded its market share. In industry comparisons, BI sales reps moved from number 39 to number 1 in the eyes of physicians. What started with a simple process of deconstructing the conversations between reps and doctors ended with an incredible success story that has continued for more than 20 years. As reps and physicians embraced the new approach, profits soared. Success is contagious, and our work had a ripple effect across the company. Soon, management and leadership teams wanted to adopt the collaborative approach we had created with their sales reps. So we continued to build leadership, innovation, and management programs all across BI. Today, more than 2 decades later, the sales team is still using this approach as the foundation of their sales training programs and for advanced sales development programs for seasoned reps. Creating the conversational space for mindfulness. Conversations have purpose in our lives. The most exciting work you'll learn about in this book is how to navigate the 3 levels of conversations. Level 1, transactional. How to exchange data and information. Level 2, positional. How to work with power and influence. And level 3, transformational. How to co-create the future for mutual success. All 3 levels are hardwired into our brains, and all are important. We can get stuck in any one of them and find that our conversations become unhealthy and lead to distrust. Or we can thrive in all of them and find that our conversations are not only healthy, but achieve transformational results. Healthy conversations are built on high levels of trust. And throughout conversational intelligence, you will learn more about the three levels of conversation. According to the research of Angelica Demoka, PhD, and other neuroscientists who use fMRI, functional magnetic resonance imaging, technology to study what happens inside the brain, trust is centered in the prefrontal cortex and distrust in the amygdala and limbic areas of the brain. How do we know? These areas light up when a research subject is asked to respond to questions or to perform activities that stimulate trust or distrust. The networks involving trust and distrust are, of course, complex. However, it's important to know that their locations in the brain are distinct. The fact that the brain processes these two responses separately offers a core insight into how to develop conversational intelligence. We can't connect to others if our amygdala is overactive. Fear and distrust close down our brains. This book focuses on how you can create the conversational space that creates deeper understanding and engagement rather than fear and avoidance. As you read and absorb the wisdom garnered from my 30 years of client engagements, I will ask you right up front to prime your pump as you read and to remember these three things. 1. Be mindful of your conversations and the emotional content you bring, either pain or pleasure. Are you sending friend or foe messages? Are you sending the message, "You can trust me to have your best interest at heart," or "I want to persuade you to think about things my way"? When you're aware of these meta messages, you can create a safe culture that allows all parties to interact at the highest level, sharing perspectives, feelings, and aspirations, and elevating insights and wisdom. 2. Conversations have the ability to trigger emotional reactions. Conversations carry meaning, and meaning is embedded in the listener even more than in the speaker. Words either cause us to bond and trust more fully, thinking of others as friends and colleagues, or they cause us to break rapport and think of others as enemies. Your mind will open as you see the connection between language and health, and you'll learn how to create healthy organizations through your conversational rituals. 3. Remember, the words we use in our conversations are rarely neutral. Words have histories informed by years of use. Each time a new experience overlays another meaning on a word, the information all gets collected in our brains to be activated during conversations. Knowing how you project meaning into your conversations will enable you to connect with others, and in doing so, let go of much of the self-talk that diverts you from working together effectively. By understanding how conversations trigger different parts of the brain and stimulate certain habits and behaviors, you can develop and grow your conversational intelligence to build healthier, more resilient organizations in the face of change. Enjoy the ride. Part 1. Conversational Intelligence and Why We Need It. 1. What we can learn from our worst conversations. I know that you believe you understand what you think I said, but I'm not sure you realize that what you heard is not what I meant. Pentagon spokesman Robert McCluskey during a press briefing about the Vietnam War. Conversations are multidimensional, not linear. What we think, what we say, what we mean, what others hear, and how we feel about it afterward are the key dimensions behind conversational intelligence. Though conversations are not simply ask and tell levels of discourse, we often treat them as though they are. Good intentions, bad impact. A decade ago, I had a coaching client who I knew from the outset was going to be challenging. As it turned out, we fired each other after 6 months. None of us likes to fail, let alone anticipate the prospect of failure. When my client, let's call him Anthony, interacted with me, he came across as a tough, arrogant executive who lived inside his head and didn't share his feelings. In retrospect, I know we were caught in our biases about each other and about what coaching involved. I was trapped in a dance of distrust with my client. But at the time, I didn't know enough to understand that I, the coach, was being thrown off by the very set of skills I would acquire over the next 15 years. Coaching requires that you know yourself first. From that platform, you can help others know themselves. If a coach, in this case me, is not seasoned enough or aware enough to handle a difficult client like Anthony, she is not the right coach. But I didn't know this yet, and I plowed forward in our conversations, believing I would figure out a way to penetrate his shell and connect with him. Feel good and feel bad conversations. When we are having a good conversation, even if it's a difficult one, we feel good. We feel connected to the other person in a deep way, and we feel we can trust him. In good conversations, we know where we stand with others. We feel safe. In our research over 30 years, trust is brought up as a key descriptor of a good conversation. People will say, "I feel open and trusting. I could say what was on my mind." Or, "I don't have to edit anything, and I can trust it won't come back to hurt me." Conversations are the golden threads, albeit sometimes fragile ones, that keep us connected to others. And why is that important? Human beings have hardwired systems exquisitely designed to let us know where we stand with others. Based on our quick read of a situation, our brains know whether we should operate in a protective mode or be open to sharing, discovery, and influence. The neural network that allows us to connect with other human beings was discovered in 1926 by Konstantin von Economo, who came across unusually shaped long neurons in two places: in the prefrontal cortex of the brain, the anterior cingulate cortex, ACC, and in the frontoinsular, FI cortex. What von Economo discovered is that these neurons extend into the gut, literally the stomach, and inform our instinctive network by responding to socially relevant cues, be it a frowning face, a grimace of pain, or simply the voice of someone we love. This network of special neurons, now referred to as VENs, enables us to keep track of social cues and allows us to alter our behavior accordingly. This is one of our most powerful and profoundly active networks, yet it is one relatively rarely discussed in the neuroscience literature. My assumption is that it's not discussed because researchers are still not sure how it impacts observable behavior, which is easier to study than instincts or intuition. Networks connected with the stomach, often referred to as gut instinct, are simply a difficult research subject. It is much harder to design a study and draw conclusions about internal workings than about behavior, and scientific research is designed to help us draw conclusions. When we are in conversation with others, perhaps even before we open our mouths, we size them up and determine whether we trust or distrust them. Once this happens, our brains are ready to either open up or close down. Bad conversations trigger our distrust network, and good conversations trigger our trust network. Each influences what we say, how we say it, and why we say it. And the networks even have a heavy hand in shaping the outcomes of each conversation. Conversations trigger neurochemistry. At the moment we make contact with other people, biochemical reactions are triggered at every level of our bodies. Our heart responds in two ways, electrochemical and chemical. When we interact with others, we have a biochemical or neurochemical response to the interaction, and we pick up electrical signals from others as well. As our bodies read a person's energy, which we pick up within 10 feet of the person, the process of connectivity begins. We experience others through electrical energy, feelings, which we have at the moment of contact. On top of this, we layer our old memories about the person, ideas, beliefs, or stuff we make up, all while trying to make sense of who he is. Can we trust him? Will he hurt us? Can we connect and add value to each other's lives? Making stuff up. What made my conversations with my former client Anthony so bad? Many of us have grown up believing that conversations occur when two people give and receive information from each other. What we know today is that conversations are multidimensional and multitemporal. That means that some parts of the brain process information more quickly than others, and our feelings emerge before we are able to put words to them. The things we say, the things we hear, the things we mean, and the way we feel after we say it may all be separate, emerging at different times. So you can see how conversations are not just about sharing information. They're part of a more complex conversational equation. When what we say, what we hear, and what we mean are not in agreement, we retreat into our heads and make up stories that help us reconcile the discrepancies. My frustration with not being able to have an open and trusting conversation with Anthony led me to start making movies about him in my head while we conversed. I found myself being very critical of Anthony's ways, his style of talking, and his intentions. I found myself leaving empathy behind and putting judgment first. I imagined Anthony as an arrogant bully and continued to embellish my feelings about him until I cast him as the worst leader I had ever met. At times, I imagined that Anthony didn't have any feelings and was out to prove that he was right and I was wrong. The better my movie-making abilities got, the less able I was to really connect with him and help him as a coach. To be fair, Anthony had a huge challenge in front of him. He had been hired as the new president of a global publishing company poised to transform its offerings from print to digital. Some saw Anthony as the next CEO, conditional upon his successful completion of my 6-month executive coaching process. We both had a lot riding on our engagement. Failure to connect. I'm not sure if it was my fear of failure or Anthony's stubbornness and low level of awareness that took me off my game, or, worse yet, a combination of both. I was convinced that he didn't get how important connecting was, and I also told myself he didn't really care. By the time I had cast our relationship in hopeless terms, I was unable to do what a good coach should do: facilitate a wake-up call for change. Instead, by slipping into my own movie-making, I contributed to our failure to connect. After making several attempts to put the subject of connectivity on the table with Anthony during our first few coaching sessions, I realized that he, too, was composing, directing, and starring in a movie in his mind about who he was, what he needed to do to be successful, and why I was wrong and he was right. I remember leaving one of the early sessions feeling insecure about my coaching abilities. At times, I even felt like the coaching roles had changed. He was driving, and I was being taken along for the ride. In my mind, I had really messed up as Anthony's coach. I failed to connect on the very important subject of connecting, and this missed opportunity could be life-changing for him, and perhaps even life-changing for me. The push and pull of conversations. Upon reflection, I realized my fear of failure made me push Anthony harder. We were both caught up in being right, and neither of us knew it. When we are trapped in our need to be right, we want to win, we fight to win, and we go into overdrive trying to persuade others to our point of view. When we are out to win at all costs, we operate out of the part of the primitive brain called the amygdala. This part is hardwired with the well-developed instincts of fight, flight, freeze, or appease that have evolved over millions of years. When we feel threatened, the amygdala activates the immediate impulses that ensure we survive. Our brains lock down, and we are no longer open to influence. You'll learn how to get unstuck and become more agile in part 2 of this book. Our primitive and executive brains. Executive brain, prefrontal cortex. Primitive brain, amygdala. Neocortex, limbic brain, heart brain. Figure 1-1. Please refer to this figure on the accompanying PDF download.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.